Hello, everyone. Welcome, and thank you very much for inviting me. And I could say that I hope you won't regret it by the end of this hour. And I'm saying that actually quite seriously because in coaching, the sort of habit of coaching or the intent of coaching is to ask people questions. Well, what would you do about this and that sort of thing? So we're not autocratic and saying this is the right way to do things. Coaching is very different to that. It's more like asking people what they would like to do and trying to encourage people to do the things that they are motivated to do themselves because they perform better when they're making their own choices. And it's quite important to have this rather big change that's going on from autocracy to a more coaching type of behavior in organizations for both management and leadership and so on and so forth. So coaching is more gentle in that way. But what I would say this is that if I take an example quite simply, when somebody needs to get up in the morning, you don't go in there and say, "And now what would you like for breakfast?" if they are asleep. Or, "When would you like breakfast?" You know, that is no good if they are asleep. They need an alarm clock, don't they? Now, how do you react to the alarm clock when it wakes you up in the morning? You know, sometimes I imagine you think, "Oh, great, I've got to go, or I need to get up, and I need to get going," and that sort of thing. I bet there's other times when the alarm clock goes off and you think, "Oh, damn, I should throw that out of the window." And do we all have both of those feelings at different times in our life? So, I was just actually going to say that, because what I was going to say is my role is that I quite often play the alarm clock. And because I think a lot of people don't, you know, really get wakened and so they can act properly. And I've seen that in a lot of different things. So I just use that metaphor. You can interpret that for yourself. But, you know, it's not much good trying to coach somebody if they don't want to change or they don't like anything. You know, you're not going to get very far that way. So we've got to make sure the person is, shall we say, awake. You know, not only awake in their physical sense, but awake in their thinking, their openness to think. So I'm going to say right now that I want to have this an awakening afternoon. So I hope we're going to start off with quite a sort of feeling of being awake. And I'm putting up three things here, and I'll put them up one at a time just quickly to suggest that things change. Our world is changing, isn't it? Our world is changing a lot. And we've had this problem for only 2 or 3 years now that has been extreme. But there are people who will remember back to 1929. Remember the crisis, the economic crisis, 1929, 1930? Any of you remember that? There was another one in the 70s. There have been different times when we've had economic crises, and then we've had other types of crises. There was a crisis between America and Russia when Russia went down with nuclear weapons around Cuba and that area. And people were very afraid we were going to have a complete meltdown at that time. So I just wanted to say those things because these things do happen. That is life. These things happen and we have to recognize that things do sometimes change dramatically. And we need to be able to respond to that appropriately. And fear is one of the things that stops us responding appropriately because we're too afraid. You know, I just want to go and hide. Some people have there's a disease that I would say is very rife in humanity at the moment. It's called denial. The easiest way to avoid something is say, oh, I don't want to know about that, I'm too busy. So they push things on one side, and that's just a form, it's a means of denial. Okay, and I'm just pointing out something here, that I'm just pointing out three things here. There are issues not just to do with 2007 and the current economic problem, but we have longer term problems, and I just put three of them up here that I consider to be quite important ones, that actually coaches should already be thinking about and saying, well, wait a minute, what is my role as a coach? And let me just start by saying that let's imagine that we have a company making shoes, yeah? Okay? Now, I certainly, as a coach, would never go in and start telling them how to make shoes, because I presume they've got a lot more experience than I have of making shoes. I mean, if I was an absolute shoe expert and I'd been quiet about it, I might pop it in. But, you know, in principle, in coaching, we do not tell them about their products, okay? However, we do have a situation now when the world in which business is changing. Now, do business people, are they aware of the changes? Most business people are extremely busy and they're very desperate about this month's figures. And they don't want to get involved in things like climate change or whatever it may be. It's just an issue that they don't want to get into because they're already busy. So there may be a role for coaches there that says, look, if we've got an economic crisis or climate change or something, it might very well have an effect on shoemaking. But it's outside just making shoes. It's because, you know, I mean, just to take an extreme example, I mean, if we had absolute rain all the time, well, you might want to make different shoes because no good making shoes that are all, you know, you've got to make waterproof shoes, right? And so the question is, do business people know about the context within which their business happens? They're very good at their own content. But when the context changes, I'm going to suggest that they know very little. I have some experience of that, and I've talked to a lot of businessmen about it. And the denial comes very quickly. They say, oh, no, that's not my business. I don't want to deal with that. Or that's for the government to deal with. Or I'm sure some scientists will fix it. You know, they're very good at avoidance. And that's denial and avoidance and that sort of thing is very common in the business world. So, I'm going to be a bit challenging with some of the things. Is that okay? Nobody's going to get upset. Yeah. If you happen to be a banker at this moment, I'll give you this opportunity to walk out of here. A particular thing I have about bankers that I do sometimes say in the talk. But anyway, let's look at this one. Consumerism is all about, we want more, don't we? I mean, the businesses are trying to tell us to buy more to save the economy. And I mean, you know, literally, when 9/11 happened, Bush went out and said, go and buy stuff, you'll save America. I mean, it was unbelievable. You know, it's not unbelievable that Bush could be that stupid. Anyway, but consumerism, which we are all involved in, is that right? Mm-hmm. You know, you go to shops, that their basis is consumerism. That is what they want. They want to sell more stuff, okay? And they want us to make and they want us to buy more and more. And if we consider the environmental situation we're in, it is absolutely the wrong thing to do. We want to manufacture less, use less, be more efficient in the way we do things. So there's a complete conflict between these two things that are going on. And some of our governments are trying to get us to save the economy by buying more and more stuff. And then other people who I would suggest are a little bit more sensible are saying, wait a minute, it's all right to have more stuff, but if that's going to cause bigger problems, is that what we want? Okay, so I'm just asking these questions. I'm not going to come here and say, well, something is so because I know, or something like that. I'm just saying, these are the things we need to think about. Okay? That is one of them, all right? That's the easy one, okay? Number two. Oh, it's a challenging one, this. And that is that since we could say the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in 1800, does anyone remember that? Am I the only one that's that old? But in about 1800, the Industrial Revolution began. Up to that point, most people had lived locally and were supported locally, and many, many people were farmers or farm workers, and they ate the food that they grew. And that was the way society was. And we could say, in those days, before 1800, we lived on our metaphorical economy, or our income was what we made and produced, okay? And that's how the world worked. There wasn't trucks running around taking, you know, potatoes from Essex to Scotland, which is what they do now. I mean, there were tremendous amounts of transport of our food. You know, I don't know whether you know this, but I mean, there's prawns, if prawns come with shells on the outside. You can actually catch prawns in Scotland in an area that, where they've got these little shrimps or whatever you call them, scampies, that sort of stuff, you know. But you know what they do to get the shell off that? They fly them, in some cases, to the Far East, where they have people who pick the shells off, and then they fly them back to England. Now, this is sheer madness. I mean, I regard that as utterly irresponsible. Utterly irresponsible. And I'm passionate about that. Okay? So, but a lot of those things go on. A lot of things that those things go on. But it really began when what we did in the Industrial Revolution, we found coal and oil. So suddenly we had a lot of energy that took us right beyond our local produce. Suddenly we had this tremendous amount of energy that we could get from that. What happened? We did well financially to begin with. We did very well in 1830 or 40. People were getting richer. Population grew because people could now have more children because they could afford it. Very exciting time. We absolutely had not a single thought for the environment. Not a thought for the environment there. We were just taking, we thought there was endless oil, endless coal, and we could go on forever like this. And so engineering and technology became the solution. And in fact, it was the sort of path to utopia was going to come because we now had our wonderful engineering ability, and we had steel ships, we had railways, we had big bridges, things that we'd never had before because of steel made a big difference. So you see what happens here. Now, that was very attractive to begin with. Everyone, the poor and the rich, got richer. Very attractive. But we were completely blind to the environmental issue. And the damage we did then is what is happening right now. That is the cause of it. Our total blindness at that time. Okay? Now, what also happened, which I feel is more distressing to that, is that we got so technological then that engineering, we could engineer our way to utopia. We could build bigger bridges and bigger ships and do all sorts of things, all about engineering. So what happened to our education? Our education switched towards technical education and engineering. Now, what happens when you shift the emphasis of education onto that side? That may sound very attractive in a way, because you've got people who are getting all sorts of credentials that they didn't have before and abilities that they didn't have before, right? But what's the risk? The risk is very serious, because what was the original way of learning that was the most important way of learning? Well, I'll tell you, it was storytelling. It was the great learning thing. Every country, every indigenous tribe that didn't even have money or schools, that it was when the old person, the grandmother or whoever it was, sat there and the children at the campfire sat around their feet and they told stories to the children. They were not necessarily true. They told metaphorical stories, or they told, shall we say, parables, because there's learning in those things. So the grandmother who was telling the story would alter the story a bit because the children could learn something from that story. Okay? But also with stories, when you tell a story, somebody's telling you a story and you're a child, you're sitting there, what's going on in your head? Wonderful imagery. Children image like anything. That is what tremendously important in learning. Imagery is the most important thing you can have in learning. What happens with technology? I'm going to bring it right up to today. There is a growing crisis with IT. You can get very excited about, wow, we've got the internet, we can do this, and I've got this, and I've got this information, I can do this immediately, and I can play games when I want to. A lot of people have got very excited about technology in the last 30 years, especially young people, right? And you've all got phones, haven't you? And what percentage of your phones have cameras on them? Just about all of them, right? And do you know what? Absolutely insane. There's only about 10% of the people with all these technology on their phones use any of that stuff except the phone. Now all the rest is there, which is great for the people who sell this rubbish to you. It's terrific for them. I'm selling all these cameras and all these expensive things, and people pay extra for them because they've got all this stuff on them, but they don't use it anyway. Because they can't, it's too complex. They have to go and get their four-year-old to tell them how to do it. But it is absolutely crazy. Actually, when you want to use a phone, it's very helpful if you just have a phone. Because some of you, when you want to make a phone call, you look at this thing and you push all these buttons and you go through all this and, oh, finally I've got a phone. No, that's good. Now I can make a call, It was very interesting. About 15 years ago, one of my friends was very excited because he got his new phone with everything on it, I had a phone. It was a real phone, and he had all the stuff on it. And he said, look at this, I've got all my phone numbers in this thing. Absolutely wonderful. And I said, well, what does that do for you? He said, oh, I can immediately go to all these phone numbers. And he was very excited about that. And I just said to him, okay, stop. We know a number of people. Let us just make a list of 10 names of people that we know, but we don't know their number. And he said, oh, yeah, great. So anyway, we worked out 10 names. Neither of us knew the number. And I said, okay, when I click my fingers, let's get those numbers. I had all 10 when he had 2. Because I had in my pocket a little book that existed for years with phone numbers written in it. And it's so quick to just look up S, well, that's the number. And he got it. He got it. I mean, these people who have this kit, they do not know how much wasted time there are. And I've talked to some corporate, senior corporate people. I said, okay, I know you're excited about your IT, but how much lost time is there in your organization? They said, oh dear, don't let's talk about it. I said, what do you mean don't let's talk about it? I said, you need to talk about it. Because you're spending more, your people are spending more time playing with technology than getting the job done before there was any of that. And that is true, and there is a coming crisis in technology by the fact that people have just got sucked into it and it's not efficient. It's not efficient because they're not making them user-friendly, because they're making them so that you buy all these bits, so they can show off how clever they are. We need to grow up. We really need to grow up and not fall for those sort of things. And the other thing I just wanted to say about the education part of this is that the loss of storytelling is really showing up to the extent that young people today are the only branch of society that the EQ, emotional intelligence, is actually going down in the young people. And in all the other ages, it's going up slowly. It's actually going down in the younger people because they don't talk to each other. They don't use their imagination like they used to. And that is a disaster. In many ways, it's at the feet of our government because they're not managing education properly. Our education system is really suffering because of this. So I'm just saying that I don't want to go on about this one particularly because there are lots of them and I'm not going to go on them all. I just want to use that one as an example of how some of these things that go on in society, we can actually think it's all positive and isn't it exciting? But actually, it is a long-term serious problem and I'm telling you that one, okay? So that's the sort of thing I want to deal with, and obviously there's a space on there, isn't it? So we've got to have the other one. And here's another one which is quite interesting. Hierarchy is in decay. Hierarchy is in decay. We used to all have people tell us what to do, didn't we? If you go back about 50 years, probably about 90% of the people did what they were told. You know? It's just how management worked in those days. You just did what you were told, and the person was a boss, and they told you what to do. And that was normal. But what happens is, in the end, people begin to not want to be told what to do all the time. They like to be able to have some choice of their own. And as people get a little bit more mature, that becomes stronger. And then, I had a very interesting one when I was talking to a woman who had been on recruitment for a long time with a company. And she revealed it absolutely beautifully because she said, yes, it's really changing. She said, I used to interview people to see if they were right people to work for us. Now, I don't interview them, they interview me about whether they want to work there. And one of the reasons is, do they have choice and do they have freedom, or are they controlled by some boss? And if they're controlled by some boss, they don't want to work with it. And that is going to get bigger and bigger. Because there are still those people who are still sort of living in an old world of commanding and that sort of thing. And younger people are not accepting it. And two things actually in that, but two things that happened in the Middle East with Egypt. And Libya, both of those things were very, very interesting because those kind of rebellions in the past were tended to be political. In those two, it were not political. It was about those younger people saying, "This is, we've had this dictator, get him out of here. He's been a dictator for 30 years. Didn't want him anymore." Both of them. Got thrown out, didn't they? Many other countries too. The world is changing. And we have to go with that. We must go with that. And that's what I'm really talking about. So if you are interested in coaching, I hope a number of people are here, that is a process that you actually invite people to make their choices and be responsible. And I would say that coaching has arrived at this particular time in human evolution, that it has arrived at the time when people want to be more self-responsible, and coaching has grown up to provide that. And so it is a real social change issue, and it is actually an evolutionary issue, because when you are told what to do by a parent, when you're 2 years old, you'll eat this, you'll put that on, you don't do that, you know, you go to the loo now, and all that sort of thing, parents are there. That is what humanity has had probably since time immemorial. And about this time in human history, we are growing up to move away from our parents, which is a very important stage of the development of humanity right now. This is not, coaching is not a little tool to use in the workplace. It's a fundamentally different way of thinking which is with us forever. And you're pioneers at the beginning of it, and that's great. Okay? So I'm setting the scene a little bit to look at some of these other concerns that exist. And I will immediately, just on this one we've got here, let me just go one forward, and saying that this is a problem with leadership, because leadership is in decline. Because when we had this hierarchy, you know, everyone used to say, oh yes sir, yes I'll do that immediately, and we all obeyed, and we were in trouble if we didn't. But that is not the same. People are not accepting that kind of thing anymore in the way they used to. So leadership is not as strong or as respected as it was. Okay? And it's not just in the business world. You can see that in education, you can see it in every area. But when the authority outside declines a little bit, people think they're liberated, and then they start to behave badly, and then society breaks down a bit. So that is an inevitable component in a change. The change may be good, but it's going to be painful on the way. That's what's happening now. So, that causes fear. There's insecurity and fear around that sort of stuff, right? There is an old thing that I'll show you very, very quickly here. That's 2001, the Gallup poll of people in the workplace. And that's the Daily Mail putting their drama, some dramatic sort of heading on it. But, you know, 6 out of 10 people in the workplace are miserable. And when this first came out, I showed that up to a few people, and when I was working with a company, and I remember when I showed it to one company, a couple of the guys in the company said, "Is that all?" You know, and to me, when I got 40%, which I call that 40% in my exams, I was a failure. That failed my exam, didn't it? And this is entirely about leadership, and I'm just saying leadership has failed. Leadership, leaders, most of the leaders today, bankers and all these financial services, not only the financial, a hell of a lot of companies that you work in actually do not have a leadership that's even up to 50% as good as it should be, and that is true. And it's just damn difficult to admit it. It's very difficult to face the issues we need to face. Okay? It's very, very difficult to deal with that. So anyway, that's the sort of thing we're dealing with. Okay, now I just wanted to say that, you know, we're not joking about this thing about fear. And so what is said here, there's a lot of fear in the world, and one of the fear things is about, there's just perhaps another thing on the fear issue I could tell you show you very quickly before I go there, and that is this one. And that is, what drives people every day? I've asked some questions to business people and said, what pushes you? You know, you go to work in the morning, but you feel you're being pushed by something, aren't you? And what do they say? I've asked that question to business leaders. What is forcing you to, you know, you get there and you want to do something? I mean, a lot of business people feel that in a tremendous rush. Does anyone have this problem? You don't feel that in a tremendous rush for some reason? Okay. So I've asked them, what is it that drives them every day? Number one, meeting the time schedule, getting it done on time. And I bet if I asked you to put your hands up in this room, a lot of people in here feel there's pressure to get it done on time in the workplace. Is that not so? The number two answer to that question was this one, fear of getting it wrong, fear of failure of some sort. Number three is short-term financial result. All three of those are fear, aren't they? They are afraid of that. That is what is motivating most of these business leaders. And I would say that business as a whole is motivated by fear. And fear, amongst other things, apart from being very pleasant, very unpleasant, and very unhealthy, actually, you do not perform well at all if you're in fear. I talk about coaching. Timothy Galway and the Inner Game is all about dealing with the internal obstacles to performance, of which the greatest is fear. So when I say businesses fail, of course they fail, because most of their staff are afraid anyway. So they're bound to do badly anyway, and that's what businesses are. Businesses will not face up to the fact of how damn inefficient they are at the moment. They really are inefficient. They don't pass muster, most businesses. But it's so common. Well, we're doing as well as everyone else. Well, of course you are. They're all doing equally badly. All three are fear reactions. And a paradigm called trust is essential. Okay, so here we go. I'm suggesting there's two different ways we can look at the world and the way we can live ourselves. Do you live in that paradigm of fear that a lot of business people do? So that is the way, and there's a list of things that is the way they see things. We've got to grow. We've got to grow our business, grow the economy, grow this. So they're always pushing for this growing. And they have a lot of rules and regulations because they're trying to control people. And it's the fear they will lose control. More quantity. I want more. I want more. That means you're not happy with what you've got. It means you're afraid of having too little. You see? Excess. So what do people do? They buy excess because they think that'll make them feel that they're happy, but it doesn't work. You look at the psychological test, it doesn't work anyway. The people who have excess of stuff are not happy, any happier than they were before they had. You know, there are people who have, you know, 28 pairs of shoes. How many pairs of shoes do you wear? You know, they have a cupboard full of 28 pairs of shoes, and they're very pleased they've got 28 pairs of shoes. Some of them don't even have their packaging off them. So they buy this stuff and they keep it in the cupboard because they think it'll make them feel better, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work at all. The psychology will tell you it doesn't work. The statistics are there. We know the statistics. They're very well published. So all those sort of things. What we do, this is the old, when you get to teaching, we tell them what to do. We haven't got the courage to ask them what they would like to do. So there's a very different things in education. There's the coaching education or prescriptive education. Again. And then there's dependence and independence as compared to interdependence. When you get into the trust thing, people begin to help each other. They serve each other. Somebody's missing, I'll go help you. And I grew up in a society in the beginning of World War II that life was all about helping and taking care of your neighbors in the time of war. Because they're suffering from something, or you know, that sort of thing. We took care of them for them. So that's the sort of thing that went on. So you can see all these things, you've got the opposites on each line. You can look at this side, what's this side, and then what's that side. And they're just different versions of how we react to circumstances. And what happens is, when you are in this fear model, one is your life is not as happy as it is if you're in the trust model. And two is you don't do anything as well in the fear model as you would if you were in the trust model anyway. So, you know, honestly, do I need to say more to say that that is the best side to be in? But the majority of our society is in this side. Does that make sense? You get it? And that's really what I'm talking about. There are two worlds. I call it, actually, there's one earth and there's two worlds. And I think these are the two worlds that we see. And when people can manage to find how to move themselves out of this side and go into that side, I can honestly say the quality of their life is awesome. They get excited about it because here, fear makes you always worried all the time. There's always hope, and that's all excitement, positive stuff. Ah, what could I do? Yeah? It's a very different way of thinking. Okay? And what I'm saying here is that we need to have a serious look at how we run our society. And yes, it's all right coaching for business people. They're all in fear anyway. You know? We've got to look much bigger than just the business people. We need to look at society in this way, not just the corporations and that sort of thing. It's much bigger than them. You know? So I'm just putting that out and saying that I believe absolutely passionately is something. Look, it's also an oversimplification, because if you put anything in just two columns, somebody's going to say, oh, I'm not there, I'm somewhere else. Yes. But what we can safely say is that these are very much quite large segments of society in each of those. And I would say this one, you could pretty well get everyone in either one or the other of those. We feel we want to know everything, don't we? We feel it's safer if you know something than if you don't know something. So we want sort of certainty. We like to know whether this is black or white. Okay? And therefore, we make rules for ourselves, as well as the rules that exist out there. But we construct our own life story. And the people who are a little bit more on the fearful side, they have very rigid life stories. And they want to operate their life within the context of that rigidity, because they feel safe, because they know stuff. Now, the difficulty with that is it's very difficult to learn something new if you're full of all the old stuff. You have to create a space to allow new things in. If you want to learn, if you want to go on growing in your life, you have to give up the old thoughts and adopt new ones, because life is changing. Your life is changing individually because you're going through different things. There are a lot of people who go on using the rules that they did in their life 10 years ago. That's no longer appropriate. But they hold on to it because they feel safer. Okay? So, I include now, a lot of the time when I'm doing any training at all, is to start off with probably an hour and a half at least on unlearning. I'd say, I'm not going to teach you anything more. I'm here to teach you coaching. I'm not going to teach coaching until you can let go of telling people what to do. Because how are you going to coach if you keep justifying what you're doing? And so I ask people, and I invite you to do this sometime, make a list of the beliefs that you have that are important to you, that actually they're just your belief. They're not actually true anyway. But you've made up those things and you just believe on to it, hang on to it because you're in fear. We all are to some extent. Everyone has that, you know. I do too. You know, I mean, it's just, that's part of the game. So what I do in courses, I get people to make a list of all those things that you need to unlearn to create the space. It's like you have to get out of the way to create the space in front of you to take in what you want to learn. It's very difficult to learn new stuff if you're spending all your time justifying the old stuff, which is unjustifiable in most cases. So I'd love to spend some more time on this, but unlearning is extremely important. And there's just a few notes there on there just to read that quickly if you want to, and you can just see how we think about unlearning and how important it is. Okay? How are we doing?
10 minutes.
Hmm? Okay. You alright?
Yeah.
I want to change the subject. I have had to do some very big unlearning in my life. Now I'm going to tell you this. I had a very powerful spiritual experience in 1973. And it continues today. And when that happened, I had the biggest task of unlearning to deal with. Because, you know, anthology and that's the right way to do it. And that actually takes you away from who you really are. You know, do you really talk to God when you say, you know, and I'm talking about in the Christian world now, and I know there's a difference here, but, you know, I mean, we say the Lord's Prayer, like that, you say it out, you've said it 100 times before when you went to church as a kid, you know it, and you just say it. But you don't mean it, you don't feel it, you're not engaged in it, it's not your creativity. Yeah? And so there's a lot of that rigidity, isn't there? Well, that's one level of rigidity, but the other thing is that in most religions, there's a rigidity in their beliefs that they expect everyone to accept those beliefs. Now, most of the things that came into religion at certain times when they were developing were things that, you know, I mean, again, Christianity, you know, forgive me using that example because it's an obvious example to me, but it's in all religions, I will say that. And that is, you know, Moses go up to the top of the Mount Ararat or whatever it was to collect the 10, you know, commandments, didn't he? Something came in. Actually, it was a sort of, he went in and he had this inspirational thing that suddenly came. What do we call that? He just got a message, right? That happens all the time, doesn't it? There are a lot of people here who can get and receive messages, okay? It was just that, you know, somebody maybe pretty smart said to, you know, Moses, how about this lot? Yeah? Now we call that person God. Because, you know, it must be God because he's outside there. You know, we don't see this guy in the white hair and the beard and all that sort of thing. I'm sorry I've got a white hair and a beard. I'm not trying to prove it. But the trouble is that we get stuck in the same place in religion, don't we? We get stuck with believing what we heard. And the trouble is that most of those things were heard now true in Brahma. Yeah? But in take Christianity, for example, it comes from thousands of years ago, and that's the way it is. Now what does that mean? Has God left? Doesn't change anything, it keeps going the same it is. Oh, God checked out. And we just kept going anyway. You know, I would have thought it was fairly obvious that if there is a God, you know, God probably wants us to be a little bit different today than he did yesterday. But we're not allowed to think that because that's not in the book, because it's not how you write it. When are we going to wake up? Because I think we've got massive problems in religion because I think we've got stuck in religion. And we had a little conversation before, and I think that is not the case in Brahma Kumaris to anywhere near the extent it is that I'm talking about traditional religions like Islam or Christianity and Judaism and those sort of things. But if we say that, you know, God disappeared 2,000 years ago, well, we're pretty well out of date, aren't we? If that's the case, because I'm quite sure that God will want to say something different about our world today, wouldn't it? But we're not allowed to talk about that because it's not in the Bible. And I think we've got a problem. I think we've got a serious problem. Now, I thought that when I was at school. And my parents used to go to church every Sunday, and I used to do that sort of thing. And I thought it really spoiled a good playing hour that I could play, and I had to go to church and do that stuff. But I did notice way back then that there was a difference between the old-fashioned Old Testament stories, which was mainly battle stories, and Jesus' life as a fisherman. That was much more interesting to me than a lot of old war stories. Yeah. So there are different things there. But having said this now, and I'm not going to take too long about this, we do have a question time a little bit this afternoon. I'm willing to explore some of these things when we get to the question time. But let me tell you, I want to say to you first of all that I'm a bit anxious at this moment. Because I know that it's not going to be the same for everyone here. You have different thoughts about this. But I'm just going to tell you, I have come back today from a meeting with a group of people. I brought together a group of women about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, because I think women have a tremendous lot to offer in our society, and I think men have made most of the mistakes, whether it's anything, wherever you go, you know, men, it's wars, and they have more car accidents, and they steal more, and most of the bad stuff in the world is done by men, right? I actually think it's very important that we pay a lot of attention to what women have to offer, and it's very, very interesting. There are far more female coaches than there are male coaches professionally. Because women have a capacity to consider alternatives and then say, well, I know this is it. And it's very interesting. I came from very macho sport. I used to be a professional racing driver, and I was sort of, you know, top of the league. I was European champion in my class, and I was a British champion and that sort of thing. And so, you know, I was good at stuff and that sort of thing. And racing, and motor racing, is more male than any other sport. I mean, there are very few women racing drivers, okay? So that was the world I grew up in and that sort of thing. Very interesting. Most of my friends were sort of macho men. You know, most of my friends now are women. Because I have better conversations with women than I do with men most of the time. Really, I'm absolutely serious about it. I think there's two very exciting groups. One is women, and the other is there is an element, a segment of young people who are not those people who are caught up in all the silly things we talked about today, who are very, very good people and really thinking young people. And I think they need a lot of support and a lot of help. Okay, now I'm going to tell a story because I wandered off onto that to not say it, to avoid it a little bit. But I'm going to tell you this. Back in that time, I had a particular experience where there were four of us being given information about how the world worked in great detail. And it started, believe it or not, in 32,000 years ago, which is actually when the Neanderthals died out and Cro-Magnon replaced them. And Cro-Magnon, we all know, were brighter than Neanderthals. Anyone that's still a Neanderthal here? If you are, you know, put your hand up, please. But no, there's a difference in humanity there. But what we were told in great detail over a period of 2 years of continuous conversation was the process of how humanity developed, because it was going behind, and there was, and whoever we want to say it is up there, took extra attention because humankind was not accelerating in or evolving as fast as it should have done. And this was explained to us in incredible detail. It took 2 years to tell us this information, partly because we could only cope with a certain amount at a time. Okay? And we were also having therapy from them as well, which is, you know, because we were all looking very much, very deeply at our own personal development to be able to even handle this sort of stuff. But what emerged out of that was the story of how each of the religions developed at which time in society and why they developed. What was the reason for that religion emerging that had certain beliefs that those things, instead of being there, for example, do you know that if you're an Orthodox Jew, that you use different knives, forks, and plates, and cups for milk and for meat? Anyone know that? But those people who really obey the rules, that's what they do. And that was given to us as one of several, many examples that we were given. That at a certain point, the outside intelligence said, we've got a problem here because the Jewish people in those days were wandering around in the desert, so they were nomadic, okay? And they didn't live anywhere because they'd got out of Egypt and all that sort of thing, and that was going on. And so what they did was they had goats with them, because they took, cows were too big and heavy. Yeah, they took goats with them, and what they were doing was eating the goat's meat, of course. They were eating the goats, but they were also drinking the goat's milk, which is a very healthy type of milk. But what they also did is they couldn't make plates because the sand and all that sort of thing. So the things they ate out of were things they cut out of wood, so they made wooden bowls. Now, what they used to do when they were moving all the time, they would eat this piece of meat from the goat, and they would put whatever they hadn't eaten in the wooden bowl, and they would carry that on their back. What happened? The milk causes the meat to go bad very quickly, and many of you would know that. Anyway, milk has an effect on the thing. And they got some advice from outside to say, if you have two bowls, keep one for one and one for the other, you won't have that problem. Now, that became a religion. And there are many, many, many things in global religions that were very good advice given by a higher intelligence to humanity that you need this to help things going along. We were told many others, including circumcision, and I won't go into that now, it's not a very nice one if you will. But a lot of these things were shared with us, and then we could understand how the thing, and when, you know, somebody, when Muhammad comes along to this group, 200 or 300 years after Jesus, and goes to a different group, and they have a different set of problems, so they get that bit of advice, which is different to that. So now we've got this religion, we've got that religion over there, and of course we have a conflict. And what we have been told very clearly is there is one system, and that we have got different stories that we make up ourselves about those different stories, and there is one universal story. And we've been given this in great detail. And just to end up, because this is coming to an end, and sorry about that, but just to end up, I asked, because communications continue, and now in our 35th year of communications, and I asked the other day, what does humanity If you had to say to humanity one thing right now, what would you say to, if you wanted to advise humanity? And they said two things. One is, there is no death. And that is, whether you take it as reincarnation or going to heaven or whatever, it is up to you. Okay. We've got a lot of explanations about that, but there is no death. And the other one is, you are not alone. And they mean, we are not alone on this planet. There are other intelligence in the universe. Okay. And both of those things are fear. People are afraid that they'll die, and they're afraid that they're alone. Fear. So I said to them that this is both fear, and that's the thing. Then the very last communication I had, which was a very short time ago, I said, okay, just update for the last year, where are we now? And they said, there's one thing that is absolutely crucial, and that is collaboration, not competition. And that completely tackles the economic system we have. Capitalism is a thoroughly destructive process for humanity. It creates fear, anxiety, all sorts of problems, and yet the whole world is stuck in this capitalism model. And that's the sort of level of seriousness that we have when we're talking to this source. They are global, quite beyond the global. It's a huge thing that we get told a lot. And I know that I have to end there, but partly because if I talk about this at all, I only want to go a certain distance, because I know some people begin to get nervous about it, a bit uncomfortable. And I'd rather they talk to their friends for a bit, and then if they want to know more, we can tell more. All I can say is then, in conclusion, The last communication I had was painful. Okay? Painful. Because they said, we have given you information and asked you to begin slowly to disseminate this information. We gave you that information over 35 years ago. And you are not doing it yet. And you need to come out and speak more about it. And we are a very small group of people, and we're very, very quiet about this. But having said that, there are several, there's a head of a university is involved in this, and that sort of thing, who never would say anything outside of the group. John Denver, the singer, was a part of the thing.
I'm going to have to bring it back to a close. So.
Gene Roddenberry of Star Trek. Gene Roddenberry of Star Trek. Was very involved in a lot of communication. So there's all sorts of stuff, but I'm ending there. Okay. And we will be having a question thing, and I will answer the easy questions and not the difficult questions. Okay.
Thank you very much. I'd like to introduce Sister Maury now to come onto the stage and to join us. Many of you will, of course, be familiar with Sister Maury, but even if you are, you may really not know what her role is. And Sister Maury, and I think she's called the Programme Director of Brahma Kumaris in the UK, but actually she's a lot more than that. She's a wonderful sister who I've known for about 20 years, and she's been teaching meditation, but particularly more than that, what she does is she really supports all the kind of initiatives that comes out from those of us who are students here, such as the spirit of coaching. She works, helps us, supports us in the different outreach projects that we've developed over the years. And she's able to talk on anything, any subject you throw at her, and she can give you a spiritual perspective to it. And so it's really great having Sister Maury with us today, because I think John's session was great, and it really set a kind of global business context with that sort of spiritual tinge, I think, towards the end, which, you know, I think it's kind of opened the pathways for us to continue that journey to look at moving from fear to trust. And so, without further ado, I'll ask Sister Maureen to take us through that journey from her perspective, the spiritual perspective. Thank
you. Om Shanti. Thank you for the introduction. I could speak about many things. I haven't tried nuclear physics yet, but I hope nobody throws that at me one day. And I'd like to thank John for your presentation. And you really gave us a very global picture, as you said. And especially what you were talking about towards the end, I know took a lot of courage, so I appreciate that. And, you know, I would kind of be tempted to develop that and go completely off track, but I'm going to discipline myself a little bit. but I think what's it's opening up, as you mentioned, is that it's really helping us to see the bigger picture. There really is a big picture to this. We are caught up in our small fears every day, and we'll talk about those things because we're also here to share with each other tools that can help us in our day-to-day living. We need that. We face those fears every day. But I think there is a bigger picture that the world is changing, time is changing, and there is an air of uncertainty all around, everywhere. And so I think that is also getting into the psyche of people everywhere. And so that fear is increasing in a way. Would you agree with me?
Yes.
Maybe. anyway, that's the big picture, isn't it? But on a day-to-day level, I agree with what John said very much, that so many of the things that we do, whether we're talking about the things that happen in government or in industry, or the things that we do on a day-to-day level in our own work, our own social interaction, our family interaction, so much of what we do is motivated by fear. And sometimes we may not always acknowledge it. But even if you just bring it to a very practical level, for example, how many of us behave in a certain way or do a certain thing because we're a little bit fearful of what others think of us? Now we say, yes, we're just trying to please everybody. And there is another disease that I think is around called people pleasing. But actually, it's fear. And sometimes, as a result of that, we don't do things or speak things in a way we're not true to ourselves. We don't do what we really believe in or what we really would wish to do. Or what we really feel is the right thing to do, even. And we really do live very often on the approval, you know, some sort of recognition. And that creates fear because it's very fragile. Today it'll be here, and tomorrow it won't be here. You know, today somebody will love me and praise me and tell me nice things, and tomorrow, that's where we say, Om Shanti. You know, they'll tell me the opposite. And this fear of insult is quite a motivating force. I don't want to upset anybody, I don't want anyone to throw rubbish at me, but of course it happens and we have to deal with it. I actually just wanted to comment on consumerism because, you know, we do that out of fear, keeping up with things, and somebody gave me a very interesting quote. And they said, consumerism means buying things that you don't need with money that you don't have to impress people you don't know. I thought, that's true. This is where we're at. And fear is motivating that in one way or another. And so I need to deal with that. I need to look at it. There's a saying, he who fears something gives that power over himself. Right? If I fear a particular person, for example, the more I fear them, I'm then actually giving them an invitation to overpower me and do that which will be fearful for me. And fear becomes a kind of habit. You know, once you're fearful about one thing, and what is fear? You think about something over and over again, and you allow your imagination to build that up into something that is not real. I think we all know that acronym, false evidence appearing real. But we're building it up into something that is no longer reality. And what remains with me as reality is my fear of that thing. And I think we all know about the law of attraction, you know? Whatever you give out, I've experienced in my life, you have. It comes back to you like an echo. And so if I give out that fear, then I attract negativity, basically, towards myself. I was looking up some quotes, you know, and one of them said that a person in a position of danger doesn't need to pray to God for safety, but for deliverance from fear. Because when I'm in a state of fear, it's not possible for me to have any clarity as to what it is I need to do to take myself out of that situation or to help others out of that situation. Because what are we here for? You know, fear tends to be quite limited. I then become quite selfish. I need to protect myself. But by contrast, a spiritual attitude, a spiritual awareness, is something that has the attitude of giving. We want to give, we want to help. We're more expansive. And so what really is at the root of fear?
Fear of loss.
Fear of losing something, definitely. But what am I losing?
Love.
Self-respect. Okay, we can make it into a discussion. Yeah, I'm fearful of losing all those things. Self-respect, love, position, power, all of these things.
Lack of faith.
But actually, insecurity. But actually, if you get down to the root of it, the basis of fear is in one little word.
Yes.
Ego. Oh, yes. It's my ego that creates fear. That false perception of myself. That self that I want to use to impress others. And in fact, one of our elder sisters, I think it was mentioned earlier maybe, that our university is headed by women, and she's in her 80s now, I think, and she's very, very humble. And I think it was last year we were asking her about ego, and she said, she didn't really know about it. It's quite amazing. But I've heard her say one thing. She said, ego means ego. And I have to think of that to myself, you know, when you get caught up in your ego, which we all do. Ego. I don't want you anymore.
That's
wonderful. So that ego is at the root of our fears. Because if I have a certain perception of myself that I want everyone else to buy into. Ego is about the false self. It's not about the real self. And that false self needs feeding. It needs feeding by recognition, by praise, position, all of those things. But it also leaves me very vulnerable. And so if I really am in that state of ego, then it's very easy for me to feel negative emotions. I'm actually in a state of weakness, and people can manipulate me very, very easily. There's a saying from that I always remember of something that Daddy Janki, who's the head of our organization now, shared. She said, it's, and I've often quoted it, so some of you will have heard it before, it's a lack of wisdom to think that the one who insults me is my enemy, and the one who praises me is my friend. Is that what my happiness is based on? Makes sense, doesn't it? It's so easy to be bought by praise. We have to be very careful with the praise. Because then I become dependent on it. The ego is very, very dependent. And so I have to move to a position of inner security that's independent of all the things that may be thrown at me in my day-to-day life. And there are challenges all along the way, right? Constant challenges. We need to be very strong. Again, another story, this one, that really has an impact on me. Again, a story that Daddy told, and I may, some of you have heard me tell it. But she was near our headquarters in India, and there was a group of people gathered. And so she went over to have a look. What are they doing? And it was a snake charmer. You know, they do exist. I haven't seen, you might have seen. But they play, and then it was a poisonous snake who stood up straight, right? And once the snake stood straight, then what the snake charmer did, he grabbed hold of the neck of the snake and squeezed it hard so that all the poison squirted out. And then Daddy said, this is the strength you need to live in this world. And it kind of hit me personally. I have to be that strong that not only can I rid myself of my own demons within, the poison within, if you like, my own negativity, but to be able to remove the negativity from others. Now that's a real giving, isn't it? That's a real strength. So this real self is not the self that you can see. And I know many of you know this. As Juliet said, the meaning of Om Shanti, I am a peaceful soul. Now that soul awareness, that soul identity, is something that is complete and whole in itself and doesn't need anything else to feed it. And it's that awareness that can enable us to have that inner security that can move us away from fear. It's something that I have to understand, I have to realize, and then after that, I have to practice it. Because it's great having the aha moments, but if you don't follow up, the aha moments become oh, moments, you lose it. This is about our spiritual practice. So when I ask myself the question, who am I? I won't like to say I'm Maureen, I okay, you need the labels, and we have a lot of labels. The labels of, you know, name and profession and culture and ethnicity and everything else. And I would add religion too. It's become a label, unfortunately. And a lot of the things John was saying was very interesting. Anyway, I won't go off track. The labels are not me, but I am the being within that uses the costume of my body to interact with life. Who is speaking and who is listening right now? If the soul was not in the body, would you hear anything? Don't leave your body, stay here. You don't want to deal with corpses. Of course not. But the soul is the energy, the living energy, that is aware of itself. And the soul, in its original form, is filled with many treasures, with peace, with love, with purity, with happiness, with wisdom. And when I become aware of these treasures within, I then don't actually need anything from the outside. And I begin to have the courage to let go of my ego. At first it's very scary, because how will people relate to me? Will people think I'm strange? You know, what is it? Actually, you don't change in that sense, you're still you. But internally, you no longer have that fear, and you're no longer doing things out of the motivation of fear, and you become free. Being free from ego is true freedom of the self. And of course the virtue that goes along with that freedom, well, two things really. First, true self-respect, because I value myself because of who I am, because I am a valuable being. I don't value myself because of what you'd say to me, or because of the nice clothes I wear, etc., etc. That does not give me value. What gives me value is who I am inside. And that's my choice. That's up to me. You can't make me that. I can't make you that. As a soul, I have value. So that inner security brings us that self-respect. And it also brings that other quality that sometimes people think is a weakness. It's not actually a weakness. Humility. You know, think about the difference. How does the power of ego work? And how does the power, spiritual power, work? There's a vast difference. Ego has to be fed, ego has to overpower something else. Ego has to be in control. And I think we all fall prey to wanting to control at times. Anybody here who's not a control freak? Comes out, doesn't it? And spiritual power is able to let go. It's not forceful. It's very gentle, it's very caring, it's very tolerant, patient, and content. Without a spiritual awareness, it's very difficult to be content. Consumerism, you know, all the advertising is doing is making us discontent, so we have the illusion that we want more, and we become addicted. When we want to lose fear, we have to get to the root of who we truly are. And there's a trajectory. The awareness of the soul, the the awareness leads to my attitude. My attitude leads to my vision. My vision leads to my thoughts. My thoughts to my feelings. Sometimes those two are quite interchangeable. And then words and actions. And of course, very often we're not aware of the trajectory. You know, suddenly we react and the words come out, and then you all know when we regret something that we've said, you know. I often think, well, the words are out there, I can't stuff them back in my mouth. They're out, they're gone. But when we're aware, then our inner motivation, our pure intention, is elevated, because it's coming from these original, elevated qualities within the self. So if I have to move now from fear to trust, I feel that there's a step in between. And that step is love. Actually, love is the antithesis of fear. And one other thing I wanted to mention in relation to fear. Fear also comes where there's a lack of truth, a lack of honesty. I had a very interesting experience. I was in the south of France in Nice at a spiritual gathering which was held at the same time as the G20 summit that was happening in Cannes in November. And we'd been told a bit about the security arrangements. And there was such a place of millions on security. It was so tight that even the people who lived in the same street as the place where the summit was taking place, they had to leave their homes and go and live in a hotel, of course, all paid for by the government. And I thought to myself at that time, so much security, so much fear, such a lack of truth. And I'll tell you a contrasting experience, even, which is very, very powerful. I had the privilege, the fortune to represent Daddy Janki at the funeral of Pope John Paul II. And it was such an amazing experience. And the people of other faiths were at the top of the square, so we were not in the crowd. We were right there. Actually, next to us were the 200 heads of state present. Crowned heads of state and political heads of state. That's the famous time when Prince Charles gave the handshake to Mugabe and it was out of his protocol or whatever. Anyway, these 200 heads of state. And then there was the Jewish and Islamic communities and then the other faiths, the rest of us. And, you know, there was hardly any security in the square that day. But what security would we have? And I thought, you know, any terrorist could get a good hole in one, right? One bomb and they're all gone. But I knew that that place was completely safe. I had no fear, but I knew it was safe because of the spiritual power of that man. I may not have agreed with all the things he said, or that's another issue, but his true love for God was protecting that square that day. Now imagine, I don't need to say more about the contrast. But moving from fear to trust, we need love. We need to love the self. We need to love others. And to love God. Without love, there can't be trust. If I love myself because I know who I am, I know my inner identity, then I begin to trust myself. And this is very interesting. Many of us, for a long time, we haven't trusted ourselves. Either you do something, or you say something, or you have an ambition, or whatever it is, and there's this nagging doubt, you know, that commentary that goes on inside. You can't really do that. You know, what are you playing at? But when we have love for the self, based on that, think of the trajectory, the spiritual awareness, then whatever thoughts come to me will be from that pure motivation, will be pure inspiration, and I will learn to trust it. I've learned to trust it in my life. You know how you say, I should have caught that thought, you know? You learn to trust yourself because you will only do what is right, actually. And then, of course, there's the whole thing about loving others and trusting others. And that's often a whole much more difficult, right? Because people are not what we want them to be very often. There was an interesting thing that, again, Daddy said about appreciation. She talks about this quality quite a lot. It's so important to appreciate each other. And she said at one point, it's good to appreciate someone in the right way before someone else appreciates them in the wrong way. So I asked her, I said, well, how can I be sure that I'm appreciating them in the right way? In other words, you know, you can appreciate someone, I was sharing this yesterday, you know, to make them dependent on you, this whole thing of praise. Or you can appreciate someone to empower them. You don't need anything, but you want to empower them and encourage them. And so I asked her, well, how can I be sure that I'm appreciating them in the right way? And she had an interesting answer. She said, appreciate them for how God or the divine has made them an instrument to do what they're doing. And I found that answer so interesting. Her answer was really saying, elevate your consciousness not to see anybody as ordinary. And again, the whole thing of the echo, whatever we give out gets reciprocated. There's another saying that I read, that if you want to make somebody trustworthy, the best way is to trust them. Otherwise, how will they live up to your trust? So trusting others is about seeing that in them. But I would also add that when we're in that spiritual awareness, we have powers. I don't mean occult powers, but practical powers. And one of those powers is the power of discernment. Because in trusting others, we trust. Our attitude is a trust. But we also need to have the clarity to discern what is the appropriate interaction. But it'll work because it's coming from the love that you have within and the love that you have for others. The motivation is a pure one. Love the self, trust the self, love others, trust others. I think many of you would have heard the story of Camilla Batman-Gelich. You may know of her. She's been quite a frequent broadcaster at one point. And she started this kids company. And it was started off in South London. I think it's moved. But a few of us have gone to visit the scheme. And basically, it's a place where children who are excluded from school. But not only that, it's like nobody wants to know them, social services, nobody. And she would take these kids during school hours and educate them, work with them, and so on. And she was telling us a story about how things developed, and she was saying that what she was finding happening was that she was, at the beginning, she was quite frequently having to go to court to defend the children because either they would dodge their bus fares or they would be stealing food. And for some of the children, you know, they would come to the scheme, come to the place without breakfast. You know, they were just not cared for. So naturally, how would they understand how to interact in society in a loving way? And so then she met with her people. So there were the psychologists, and there were the people who themselves had been, you know, very marginalized and delinquent, or whatever the word is, and who themselves had transformed their lives and were now working to help these other young people. And she said to them, okay, from tomorrow, when the children come here, we're going to feed them and we're going to give them their bus fare. And these two groups of people attacked her, well, not physically, literally. And the psychologist said, well, that's just rewarding them for their bad behavior. And the other group said, well, you know, nobody did that for us when we were, you know, in that condition. Why should they get it? You know? And she said, for a moment, I wavered. I thought, am I doing the right thing? And then she said, no. She said, I'm the director of the scheme. This is what we're going to do. And she said, that turned everything around. And so the violence decreased, the bad behavior, everything, and the children began to transform through love, really through love and trust that it's possible for them. Now, we need to do that in our everyday lives, don't we? We don't often meet people so challenging, maybe we do, but in the less challenging situations, this kind of interaction will begin to spread a wave of goodness, which is something that the world so badly needs, because people are in that grip of fear. And, you know, love is something that's not talked about too much, is it? You know, somebody who's a police trainer, well, he's now left the police force, but he was telling me once he had gone to do a training, and he thought he was seeing new recruits. So he said, he thought, well, if they're new recruits, I will, you know, do something different. He's a very spiritual person. And when he got there, it was inspectors. But he said, well, I'll do something different anyway. And at the end of the talk, he kind of leaned forward. He was telling me this was so much glee, actually. He said, he leaned forward and he said, if you want to get the best out of your men, just love them. Love them. And then he left the stage as soon as he could. And he said, the next week he was having lunch with another guy from that training school. And the guy said to him, well, your session was the most controversial, especially when you used that L word. Couldn't even say it. But that's where it's at, isn't it? From fear to love to trust. And, you know, trust is very connected to faith. I know something to be true. I know something to be right. And I trust it. And then, of course, the third, trust, love and trust, is in the divine, in God. And in a way, you know, I would say the story of this house where you're sitting now is the story of that. Because when we first built the first house, no money, you know, say to the builder, say, what's your collateral? Faith. Or very little money, a tiny percentage of what it cost. But, and I have to say, this is down to Daddy Jangi, who I keep mentioning, had total trust that if it's the right work, if it's a true service, the resources will come. And that's the way the Brahma Kumaris have functioned for 75 years, and really, that inner strength can can truly come to us through our relationship with the divine, our relationship with God. And of course, there'll be many different approaches, many different ideas about God. But I think some ideas are universal, that God is love. God is a source of love, a source of peace, a source of wisdom. And it's no use us going to God in fear, actually. If I wish to take power, the strength that I need, it's important that I bring myself into a state of trust. Because if you think about connecting, even connecting with a human being, you need to be on the same wavelength, right? You know, sometimes you see how two people are having a conversation and they may as well be talking to themselves. There's just no correlation between the two. But it's not only about words, it's about vibration. And when people connect, it's like you hardly have to say too much. You say half a sentence and you know what the other one means. As I develop that soul awareness, that awareness of my inner self, I'm bringing myself into that more refined vibration, whereby the connection with the divine becomes easy and natural. And there's a flow of energy, a flow of strength into the self. And again, as I was saying, spiritual strength, divine strength, is gentle, is very pure, and nobody can take advantage of it. You're not vulnerable with that divine strength or spiritual strength with you. And because you're not vulnerable, because you're not in a state of need, you're able to give. And so if I think about the route from fear to trust, it's from selfishness, it's from control, it's from possessiveness, towards selflessness, towards giving, towards letting go, towards enabling, and towards true being. So this is what is required of us now, I feel, what the world needs. And if all of us can start on this trajectory, so many changes are going to happen. Change happens easily. It's incredible. I, you know, you don't have to make the effort for it. It's magic, that's all I can say. Okay, thank you for listening.
I think that sort of, in a way, it seems like we try to educate the world, but and I can see us sort of informing and training and coaching, but I personally think that informing, training and coaching is not enough. I don't know, what else do we need to do?
That's a very good question. I think one of the things that we resort back to is, well, it'll work out if we do a little bit of this or a little bit of that. And that is sometimes true. So we sort of have an affirmation about that. But I do think that this is a very important time for humanity. I think this is decision time. And I think this is a really big challenge for people, because I think we've got to not just talk about leading a different life. I think we've got to actually do it. And the politicians do a lot of talking about it, and they don't do anything. And I think that we, unfortunately, always hope that the leaders will do it for us, and they'll do it if we sort of hope enough. And I think we've reached a time when, and this sounds very revolutionary, but I'm not meaning that at all, I think it is time that the public started to stand up and demand what we need to demand. we can, I mean, after Murdoch and all that stuff with the media, forget the media. You know, forget the bankers, they've all got too big a bonuses, so they don't have to do them all. You know, we've got to go to people where there is more authenticity and honesty that we see within the field that used to be our leaders. So, food for thought.
Yeah, I mean, I agree totally. It's a very, very profound change that's needed. A change at the core of how we live, our values, how we perceive things, how we take decisions, what's behind those decisions. It's a very deep change, radical change. I don't mind using the word revolution, I think it is.
Out there who have been educated, who've been to college, who've been to university. They cannot get jobs. In the old days, when my husband was young, he had an apprenticeship with Rolls-Royce. Today, thank goodness, he's a manager. But we had a conversation about this yesterday, like, why aren't there enough apprenticeships anymore? I checked the websites. Yes, there are websites for apprenticeships in
Cookery. I'm going to have to ask you to just...
Sorry. And basically, my question is to Sister Maureen, how do we go about making the changes here? Because I want to see youngsters in jobs again. Because the youngsters are going to be the people for the future who are going to make the decisions for this world. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. The fact it's interesting, we had a group of young people here yesterday, and our whole theme really was about young leaders, you know, and how leadership, as John's been talking about very much, is not an external thing only, but it's about leadership from within. But a lot of the work we've been doing, which has been with my friend Maxine here too, has been really to help spiritually empower young people. So that's one side of it, because young people do become very despondent, but like, I think John mentioned, you know, there's a group of young, there are young people who are so switched on, I would say, and really want to make a difference. And because they feel empowered and they really want to be true to themselves, they find opportunities. It's quite amazing. But it's a very sad indictment of our society that there's over 1 million young people unemployed at the moment. Just on a practical level, we had a consultation group here in October, and some people within the youth work field and within education, and we created a consultation document which is really saying that a fundamental rethink is needed, and we are, you know, working with that and trying to disseminate that idea, but I agree with you completely. I mean, I don't have a magic formula. I wish I did. I would have used it. We would have used it by now. But we need to work at these two levels to help government understand the importance of investing in young people. And of course, they get into a trap. You haven't got enough experience, so you can't get the job. How do you get the experience? So all of that, and making it possible for businesses to offer these sorts of apprenticeships. But at the same time, the other is encouraging our young people to be leaders, to lead themselves, be empowered spiritually. That's very, very important. Then they can take full advantage of those opportunities. I mean, that's as much as I can offer, I think.
I was just wondering whether it might be, if anyone was interested in this, it might be useful to make that available.
Yes.
So if you are interested in knowing the statement that we came out with,
yes,
we could email it to anybody that wanted to, and then there's a chance for people then to take it up and move it on in their own areas. So, so perhaps, what should we ask people, anybody who wants that, just leave an email contact.
Yes,
on the desk outside, and we'll email you the statement.
Thank you.
I just wanted to say a couple of things about that, if I may, about education. One is I'm very passionate about education because I feel that it's in a shocking state at the moment. And I have my main project on education at the moment is in China. We've had a lot of a team of people from Europe, different countries in Europe and to China that are exploring what do we need to do with education, how can we do education together. This whole thing is not about money, it's not about competing with companies. It's simply saying, what can we all do in the best possible way, because education is so poor right now. Now, let me just say very briefly about that. When people say, why do they go to school, or very often, if children ask their parents why they go to school, or teachers why they go to school, they say, well, you need a qualification to get a job. I'm sorry, that is a disaster. What you need to say is, this is to prepare you to go forth into the world, and in the world you'll have success, you'll have failure, you'll have all these things on your learning journey of life. And that's what we want to know. So that's one thing. There's something else that's very, very serious, and that is that I work with the European Commission on traffic safety, and I'm sure you, well, you probably all know that young males between the age of 18 and 22 are the group in driving that are more frequent fatalities than any other group. And the reason for that is because we are shocking with our education. Again, I'm really, really upset about education at the moment, and I have a very big passion about education at the moment. And I've had it actually for a very long time. But look, what we have to do with children is to give them choice and allow them to hear, to experience the consequence of the choice they make. If your child at 4 years old goes out to play without a coat on and gets cold, then that is absolutely fine, they've learned something. The difficulty is that parents or things will say, well, you idiot, you shouldn't have gone out without a coat on. Terrible mistake. When the child says, I'm cold, the parents say, okay, what do you want to do about that? And when you do that process, the child begins to learn about the relationship between the choices they make or do very quickly without making a choice and the consequence of the choice. And if you give children choices from literally 2 years old, what do you want to eat right now? If you give children choices and let them experience the consequence, they begin to build a relationship between choice and consequence. And then as they get older, you know, now they're in the age where they maybe carry a knife or take a bicycle out onto the road and all that sort of thing, they will be much more experienced at making choices, and they make much better choices. If you give your children choices, they can get 1,000 choices a year just by the little things you do in the home or in the school, if we had proper schools. And by the time they've had 1,000 choices a year, they're going to know very well how to make consequences, how to make the right choices to produce the consequences they want. And then as you go on doing that, they get better as they get older, and then by the time they get in a car and they make choices about having a drink or going to this party too late or whatever it is, they make different choices. That is crucial in education, completely missed by our schools, completely missed by our parents at the moment. Absolutely vital to give children excitement in life. Let me just finish the other one. I'm involved with David Henry, the Olympic performer with a children's charity. And what we're doing is to show children, yes, you can. We're taking Paralympic injured, serious people who are in wheelchairs who have still been able to be in the Olympics, in the Paralympics, to perform. And we've said to the children, have a look at this person. Here's this person who will talk to you for an hour and a half about what they did to get up and to go out and to do something, even though they had these terrible injuries. And that gives children hope. And those are the sort of things we need to be doing.
I don't think it's like the appendix. You cut it out or it becomes redundant. I guess it has a function or a lack of a function. Can someone describe to me what that would probably look like and how we could get there rather than it being driven by fear and its image and proving itself? Thank you.
Ourselves really, and okay, definitely we need a persona. I would say that we use that word to interact with the world. You know, if you come to talk to me and I say I'm a soul, you know, you can't talk to me, can you? You can't. So we have a personality. We have a persona. We interact. We have certain traits. Some people are more humorous. Some people are more serious. Etc. Etc. But the point is that those qualities of that persona, if you want to call it the ego, I prefer the word persona, of course it's all kind of semantics, isn't it? That those qualities are something that I, as a being, use to interact in life and to enjoy life. But it's not something that totally defines me. Because if I let that persona totally define me, then I can become trapped. So yes, I might be humorous, but if there's a time when I'm going to be a little bit different to that, I'm not lost. I'm still the same being. I mean, I'm just picking an example, but it's because we're all different at different times, but the essential being of who we are is constant. So that awareness needs to remain. But when that awareness gets lost and we get lost in the playing to the gallery kind of thing, then we compromise ourselves. So that's where we call it ego. So that would be my understanding.
Totally upset. I've been looking for an answer for myself.
My question's to Maureen. I think it may follow on from your answer to the last person who asked the question, but I just wondered if you could say a bit more about that relationship between ego and fear. I think there's been a lot of discussion about change, but what I've certainly learned for myself is that often that more complex stuff about change is at that interpersonal level, and sometimes it can be really difficult to figure out some of this stuff. So on this issue of the relationship between ego and fear, sometimes your fears may be motivated about concerns for other people and your fears for them in a particular situation, and that doesn't feel very selfish. So I was kind of, and that relationship between selfishness and ego, so I wondered if you could just say a bit more about that. Thank you.
It is quite complex actually, isn't it? And the other thing that compounds it too is when there are deep-seated things from the past which are affecting you in the present, and sometimes we're not always aware of those things. We have certain responses or reactions which often are not necessarily so related to the current situation, but it's coming from somewhere else. And it feels as if we have to clean it out, you know, and that's where the spiritual practice is very helpful in that, because in a sense, it's like we need to be cleaned of our negativity. We're all carrying stuff, really. And, you know, it can be from this life, or if you believe, you know, it can be from many lives. So there's a cleaning out that needs to happen. And then, you know, this sort of thing where I'm concerned about others. It's how to do that without allowing my fear to intrude in the situation, you know. Because, yes, you know, it's not about saying, oh, you know, go run in front of that bus yourself unnecessarily in danger, putting others unnecessarily in danger. It's about being sensible, it's about being practical. But where there's fear in me, that often clouds my clarity, and that's the problem. That emotion overcomes me. And so then I want to say to my child, don't do that. But it's because of the emotion of fear, instead of, and of course it's fear, it's attachment, isn't it? It's, you know, you feel you have to, there's somebody you have to make sure they're okay. And it's like, in a way, it's about not allowing them to have choices too, but it's like sometimes your emotion means that they get a feeling of them being smothered and then tend to go in the other direction. And so being able to be beyond fear and trusting, it's not easy. But I have experienced it in certain situations where I've known I can't do anything about this, I just have to trust. That's it. And if I'm filled with the emotion of fear, even if there's an opportunity to help the situation, I'll miss it. I have to stay clear in myself. And that's very important, and that's where fear can cloud things, you know. So I think that would be my comment on it. And there's small things, but this emotion that grips us can be destructive at times.
The fear is quite interesting for me because of my sport. I was in professionals, particularly in the 1960s when I was racing. That was the big time of, when a lot of racing drivers got killed at that time because cars were coming very fast, but they hadn't got the safety devices in them. And I would just say one story. I mean, I don't want to talk about the whole issue, but one story was an interesting thing. I don't know whether you know, but if you have a very threatening circumstance at one time, your brain works incredibly fast to try to cope with what's happening. And I found myself at one time, and this was in Italy, at Monza, and I was actually going through the air, at least as high as this room, in a car at about 140 miles an hour. And there was a bank coming, and then a bunch of, it was forest beyond it. And that was where I was going. And it's very interesting, because I had a lot of time, because your brain works so fast. And so I thought of a number of things, and what I actually just thought of was a friend of mine who had gone into a house at 140 miles an hour and lost both his legs. And I thought, well, I'm going a little bit faster than he was, and he was considered lucky, so I'm obviously going to die. So I then went into the thought, I had three mechanics with me in Monza, and I thought, which one would be the best one to make a call to my mother to say I was dead? And I worked one out which one would handle it best, and I decided he was the one that did. And then I thought, how can I make sure that he does it? And that sort of thing. And then I landed in the tree. But what was very interesting was the amount of time I had in that experience. And there, if other people here have had a near-death experience, they'll exactly know what I'm talking about. But what was so important to me, because I actually don't have fear now of death. I mean, you know, obviously I have the guidance by fear. That would be risky sometimes, absolutely. But I'm not afraid of death, and why not? Because I realized on that particular experience that the fear of death is a very, very powerful thing. But when I went into it, I actually found I was not afraid of death. And what we are afraid of is afraid of being afraid when we face death, and the fear is the painful bit. Yeah. Because actually I was very calm going into the accident, and I had a number of incidents after that where I didn't have any fear. I was just completely calm, doing whatever needed to be done extremely quickly, of course. But I realized the fear of death for most people is the fear of what you will feel at the point of death. And that was so interesting, it was so wonderful to lose it. I just don't have that problem at all because of that.
Wonderful.
I think it's about fear and love, really, recognizing that love is far more powerful than fear. I ask myself, could I allow this fear to leave? And I say to myself, I don't need you, fear, anymore, you can go now. And just allow it to go. Just let it fade away. Eventually, if you do it long enough, it'll just fade away. And you'll be free from it.
So if we could